So, as I mentioned at the start of the horse is divided into three main parts. The first part was transmission lines, which is basically talking about guided propagation. So propagation inside a certain confined media that makes sure that your electromagnetic wave is limited in the space that it moves in, such as propagating inside a coaxial cable, for example. Okay? So that's a transmission line. That's the transmission line case that we studied at the start of this course. It was the longest module and probably the one that involved a lot of ideas at the same time. Okay? The second part of the course was the module that talks about, which we just finished at the end of last week, was the part that talks about unguided propagation. So your electromagnetic wave is traveling in an unbounded medium. So the media does not have any boundaries and the electromagnetic wave goes everywhere. Okay, and in that part, we had a little bit of complicated math because we had to deal with vector calculus, so derivatives with respect to x, y, and z, derivatives in three dimensions, right? And also dealing with vector quantities. But eventually, the underlying principles in terms of physical meanings were very simple, that eventually you have in that unbounded media, we studied a specific case, which is basically the uniform plane wave, a wave which is traveling in a certain direction. The electric and the magnetic field of that electromagnetic wave are perpendicular to the direction of propagation, and they are perpendicular to each other, and there is a linear relation between them. So the magnetic field quantity or value is equal to the electric field divided by some fixed value or fixed quantity, which we call the intrinsic impedance, right? And one additional thing is that the electric and the magnetic field, they only vary with respect to space as you move in the direction of propagation. But if you move perpendicular to the direction of propagation, so the electric and the magnetic field are uniform. They have the same value. If you fix a plane perpendicular to the direction of propagation, everywhere on that plane, they will have the same value. And then we looked at an important property, which is the polarization. Okay? And today also, we will see again why polarization is important in electromagnetic waves. Now the last part is the part that deals with how can I move from bounded propagation to unbounded or vice versa. If I have a wave which is traveling inside a cable, inside a transmission line, how can I get this wave propagated into an unbounded space? The other way, if I have a wave coming from an unbounded space, how can I capture some of the energy of that wave and propagate that inside a cable in a bounded medium? And the device that does this operation, the transformation between unbounded to bounded or bounded to unbounded, is called an antenna. Okay? And the operation of changing the propagation from bounded to unbounded is called radiation operation. So, antenna. Is a device that transforms a bounded propagation to unbounded propagation or vice versa. So it can change from unbounded to bounded. Okay, if, and that's what we will see in the next couple of slides, if I start from bounded, so this is bounded propagation and my wave is traveling there, and then I carry my wave to an unbounded transmission, right? This is the unbounded side. Okay, so in this case, my antenna here is called a transmit antenna. Okay? And this operation, changing from unbounded to bounded, so this operation, changing from unbounded to bounded, is called radiation operation. Okay? The other way around, if I have my wave coming from unbounded transmission, so coming from an open area, and then I try to collect the energy of that wave such that I transform it
into bounded. So this is unbounded. Okay. And I'm transforming this to bounded. Then my antenna here, this is called a receiving antenna. Okay. So transmitting, if you are changing from bounded to unbounded, receiving, the antenna is called receiving. If you are collecting an energy or some part of the energy of an unbounded transmission and converting that into bounded transmission. Okay? That's called the receiving antenna. Now, antennas takes lots of forms. So, as you see here, they differ in geometry, they differ in the orientation of their radiated signal, direction of propagation of the signal coming out of the antenna, their capability of collecting some energy of an instant unbounded transmission and converting that into bounded transmission. But regardless of all the geometries and the forms that they take, the principles of operations are more or less the same. The basic concepts that allow an antenna to radiate, to convert bounded to unbounded, or vice versa, collect or receive, so convert unbounded to bounded transmission, are the same principles. Okay? So as far as we are concerned in this part of the course, we are going to focus only on one geometry of these antennas, which is this, the dipole antenna. Okay? And typically in real life, the most common antenna that we see everywhere is a subsection of the dipole, which is called the monopole antenna, similar to the one that you see in these access points. So each one of those antennas is a monopole. It's only one section, rather than for the dipole, you have two sections. So here for a dipole antenna, you have two parts, right? The ones that are commonly used in day-to-day life are monopole antennas, which are a subset of the dipole antenna. They actually have exact same principles of operation without any alteration, okay? So the monopole antenna is just an antenna which is composed of only single part, rather than having two parts. And the other one is basically grounded, okay? So that's called a monopole antenna, okay? That's the one that you see in these devices, that's the one that you see in cars, that's the one that you see in radio receivers. Most of these things that you see in our day-to-day life are monopole antennas, which are basically a subset of the dipole antenna. So as far as we are concerned, we'll focus our studies on this one. We'll focus our analysis and description of principles of operation on the dipole antenna. Okay. This slide is just repeating what I mentioned at the start. So antennas are basically transducers. They convert one form of propagation to another form of propagation, right? And if they convert the bounded or guided transmission to the unbounded or unguided transmission, then they are called transmit antenna. If they convert the unbounded or the unguided transmission into the bounded or guided transmission, then they are called receive antenna, right? So this is reception mode, this is transmission mode, okay? It's more or less, this is the same as what I described previously. A very important property of most of the common antenna is the property of reciprocity. Reciprocity means that the behavior of the antenna when it's transmitting, when it's taking bounded and converting that to unbounded, is very similar, is very symmetrical to its behavior when it's used for reception. In particular, what I mean by that, if you have a particular antenna configuration like this one with a particular geometry and you feed it with a signal with a certain property, okay, the end result is, for example, that the radiated signal, the unbounded transmission which is coming out of this antenna, will have an electric field, as we see in this figure, which is in general parallel in this particular antenna. The electric field, for example, of the radiated signal is parallel to the opening of the antenna. That opening of the antenna, we call it the aperture of the antenna. Okay? So for this particular antenna, if you use it as a transmitter, then the electric field of the radiated signal for this particular antenna design, the electric field is going to be more or less parallel to the opening of the antenna. Okay? This means that if you use this antenna for reception, it's only going to be able to receive electromagnetic waves that have an electric field which is parallel to the opening of the antenna. Otherwise, If it's perpendicular, if it's normal to the opening of the antenna, nothing is going to be received inside the bounded medium. Okay? This is called reciprocity. If this antenna radiates a wave which has an electric field parallel to the opening of the antenna, for example, then it will only be able to collect energy from a signal and convert that into light when it's used for reception. It's only going to be able to do that if that electromagnetic field or that electromagnetic wave has an electric field parallel to the opening of the antenna.
خلاص يا جماعه, that's a necessary condition. What if the electric field is some way inclined? Then this means that the component which is parallel is going to couple with the antenna. The component which is normal is going to cause no reception at all. So you will receive part of the energy, not the whole energy, because you cannot receive from the one which is perpendicular to the other. Again, this is for this particular antenna design. There might be another antenna design which is when radiating will have an electric field perpendicular. Then it means it will only be able to receive if the electric field is perpendicular. خلاص. So again, reciprocity means that behavior as a transmitter is what governs the behavior when it's used as a receiver. What kind of behavior? Particularly the direction of the electric field with respect to the antenna. خلاص يا جماعة. In addition to this, there is something that we'll study later called the gain of the antenna. And the gain of the antenna is the same, if it's the same antenna geometry, whether it's used for transmission or reception. So if we say that it has a gain, for example, 5 dB when it's used as a transmitter, this means that when you use the same antenna as a receiver, it will also have a gain of 5 dB. خلاص? So that's also another reciprocal property of antennas. Most of the antennas, except very specially designed ones, will have this reciprocity property. خلاص? And we don't care about the special cases. So the general case is antennas, we will consider them as reciprocal devices.
Now this brings us back to the concept of polarization. So remember that we care about the direction of the electric field in electromagnetic waves. Why? Because particularly this governs how antennas are going to interact with these electromagnetic waves if they are being received. So that's why, for example, when you go and set up your satellite receiver, you have to specify whether the expected electromagnetic wave that will come to your receiver from the satellite is vertically polarized or horizontally polarized, right? And if you specify it wrong, the antenna is not going to receive anything because it expects a certain polarization direction, and if you set it up the other way, your dish is not going to receive anything.
So that that links polarization to this reciprocity properties of antennas, okay? Now, a very important thing to keep in mind that when we study antennas in this course or in this module of the course, okay,
we are doing, or our analysis assumes that we are far enough from the antenna. So we are not, if you go, for example, with a measuring device or a sensor or whatever, and you become very close to the antenna, for example, for those ones that you see up there, if you are like within 1 centimeter, for example, from the antenna, okay, then all the principles that we discuss here are not applied. It's going to operate in a totally different way. So here, we assume that we are far enough from the antenna. How far? Again, we compare distances to wavelength. So typically, we assume that if this is my antenna, okay, then this antenna is radiating at a wavelength lambda, so the signal that's coming out of the antenna or the signal that's being received by the antenna has a wavelength equal to lambda, okay? Then I have to be, when I'm studying the electric and the magnetic field, so when I'm studying E and B or E and H, okay? And when I'm looking at my electromagnetic wave in general, I'm studying it at a point which is at least, right, a distance D that's much larger than lambda. Typically, D is greater than 10 lambda. Okay? So I am multiple wavelengths away from the antenna. Otherwise, I'm too close, right? And the behavior of the electromagnetic wave is going to be totally different from what we look at in this mathematical analysis or this analysis that we will do in the next few slides. Plus, this is called far field analysis. So we are doing far field analysis or study. Okay? Now, when you are too close to the antenna, okay, you are doing actually near field study. And in the case of near field, first of all, for most of wireless transmission applications, it doesn't happen, right? You are doing far field. You are not really doing any near field. You cannot really, your cell phone is never too close to the base station, right? And same thing, your laptop is never too close to that access point, okay? Now, if you study the near field, where are the cases where you have near field? One common application of that is if you study wireless power transfer. So when you do wireless charging, for example, okay, you are charging a car, you are charging your mobile wirelessly, okay? So in that case, you are too close to the transmitter. The transmitter is like you are a few millimeters or centimeters away from the transmitter, right? In that case, we don't study radiation principles, the ones that we will do analysis for here, the far field analysis that we do here. We are studying something called coupling. And that coupling has a totally different methodology to study, okay? So again, for typical studies that we will do in this part, we are dealing with the far field. We are not doing the coupling study. Coupling study is totally different.
So the principles for wireless power transfer, for example, so far, is being studied in the near field. And in that case, you are studying it particularly in a magnetic coupling setup. That magnetic coupling has a totally different way to look at it, okay? So that's one thing to keep in mind. Now the first
study of antennas is going to focus, as I mentioned, on the dipole, but we will start with a very special case of the dipole antenna, which is called the Hertzian dipole. The only difference between a regular dipole antenna and a Hertzian dipole antenna is,
for a Hertzian dipole antenna, I assume that the dimension of the antenna, the length of this antenna, okay, is typically much less than the wavelength. So my antenna is extremely short compared to the wavelength. Now, don't confuse those two things, okay? Being far or close to the antenna is what we discussed in the previous part, the previous slide, which has to do with studying far field. So we assume that we are always a distance d from the antenna, from the antenna itself or from the center of the antenna, we are at a distance d which is larger than the wavelength, right? Now we are discussing the dimension of the antenna itself, right? The dimension of the antenna, the wires of the antenna, the pieces of metal that composes our dipole antenna are very short compared to the wavelength, right? So L, the length of the antenna, is much smaller than lambda. Actually, typically, it does not exceed lambda over 50. So very, very short compared to the wavelength. Okay?
What's the advantage of this? The advantage of this is that we can assume that across the antenna dimension, across that L, the amount of current or the amount of signal being fed into the antenna does not have a chance to vary with respect to space, because space is too short, right? The dimension of the antenna L is too short compared to the wavelength. So this means that if I travel across the antenna, I can assume that if I'm talking, for example, about the current being carried by this antenna, I can assume that the current is almost constant across the whole antenna. Okay? It doesn't really vary with respect to space across the whole antenna.
Why? Because it's too short. So I will not have enough variation in space such that I will see a different current at different locations. Tamam? يعني, if I assume that this is my wavelength, tamam? So this wavelength discusses variation with respect to Z, اللي هو space dimension. Tamam? And my antenna is this big. Right? So across my antenna, from here to here, I can assume that the value is almost constant. I don't move much such that I will see really a big variation of my current or my voltage or any electric property signal, electromagnetic wave property, okay? So that's why I start by this.
So we start by studying the Hertzian dipole, so a dipole with a very small size, and then the typical trick that engineers use later on to study a normal dimension dipole, we will assume that it's composed of elements of length. Each one of them is a Hertzian dipole, right? So you can think of this Hertzian dipole as of dL size, right? And then you differential length size. And then when you study a normal length, you will assume that it is an integration of multiple dL, 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 dL integral, right? So that we can study the normal dipole. A typical trick You do it in every single course, right?
You hate it, but it works. Okay. So that's our Hertzian dipole. So we'll start by studying this Hertzian dipole. Okay. Now, one thing that we have to keep in mind is what's our objective of study? Our objective of study is the following setup. We have this antenna. So let me just remove the extra stuff here so we can see things clearly. Okay. So we have this antenna, right? Which is that couple of wires that you see over here, right? This part and this part, okay? And a typical way to study an antenna or a typical way to study the behavior of transforming an electromagnetic wave from guided transmission to unguided transmission is to start by assuming that your antenna is a wire, right? So you start by assuming that this wire is fed by a certain current, right? And then when you have a wire carrying current, what happens in the space around that wire? You get a magnetic field. So that's what we will do, exactly the same thing, right? So we assume that we have some current being fed into that antenna. The only difference is for this antenna to radiate, to propagate wave, that current has to be varying with respect to time, right? Okay, so we assume that our current, which is feeding the antenna, which is called I, okay, is a function of time, I of t, okay? And of course, as that current is traveling inside the guided media, it will also be a function of space, as we agreed before, right? Because it's traveling, so it must be a function of time and space as well. So we assume that our antenna is fed by a current, and that current is a function of time and space. What's the typical way to represent that? That we assume that our current is equal to some initial value, right? Multiplied by function, it's a traveling wave. So it has to be e to the minus jkz, right? So we are looking at the current as it reaches here and starts propagating inside the antenna. So e to the minus jkz, and then multiplied also by, because it's a function of time, ej omega t, and then you take the real part of this, right? That's how we represent our current as a function of time and space, right? We say that it's a traveling wave, so it must have some initial phasor value multiplied by e to the minus jkz. This whole thing is I phasor. This whole thing is the phasor of my current. So initial value and function of space. And then multiplied by e to the j omega t, and you take the real part so that you can get it as a function of space and time. Remember? That's the regular thing that we did before. And then we'll see if this is the case, if this is the expression of the current that we have here, at a distance r from the center of this antenna, okay? What's gonna be the electric field? What's gonna be the magnetic field? So we will be able to see that at any point in the unguided space around that antenna, we will have, because we have a time-varying current, we will have a time-varying magnetic field, right? Any current generates a magnetic field. If the current is time-varying, then it's going to generate a magnetic field, which is time-varying. Now, we agreed before, when we looked at the review of vector calculus and the review of time-varying electric and magnetic field, that if you have one of the fields time-varying, the Maxwell equation says that you must have the other one as well. So since at a certain point, our distance away from the antenna, we will have a time-varying, at that point Q, we will have a time-varying magnetic field, then we must also have a time-varying electric field. If we have both time-varying magnetic and time-varying electric, then we have an electromagnetic wave. And we know that that wave is capable of carrying power and energy, right? So basically, we ended up with showing that it's enough to feed any conductor with a time-varying current so that you can get around that conductor some electromagnetic field. Time varying electric and magnetic field, which represents a traveling wave, which is gonna carry some energy away from that conductor into the open space. That's the principle of operation. And our objective is to find an expression for that electric and magnetic field at a distance r away from the antenna, knowing what's the expression of the feeding current. So that's what we want to achieve. The picture is clear to everyone. So let's see how we'll do. First of all, this is the part that I discussed initially, right? Our current, which is feeding the antenna, is represented by some initial value, and it is a function of time, right? Where is the space part in this expression? Yeah, because we assume that the dipole is extremely short, right? So basically, the current across the dipole does not really vary with respect to space. Okay? Clear to everyone? We agreed that the dipole is too short, so I don't really need the variation with respect to space for the current. So for the current, I don't really need the variation with respect to space. Okay? Now let's look at another important thing that goes back to the history when we studied that, these four review chapters, the vector calculus and the one on time-varying electric and magnetic field. Remember when we looked at that chapter, I mentioned to you a nice thing, which is basically that you can have some analogy between how you represent electric field versus voltage, potential, electric potential. And similarly, you can do the same thing for the magnetic field, assuming that there is something called the magnetic potential. Remember that? You remember that quick discussion? The idea is, okay, typically, okay, electric field, when it exists somewhere, so if I have an electric field E, typically this electric field is generated from a source. And the source that generates the electric field in nature is charges, right? So remember Coulomb's law? Coulomb's law gives you the force, and then based on that force and the definition of electric field, you can get actually an expression of the electric field due to a certain amount of source, a certain amount of charge. And the expression was basically that E is equal to Q, the charge which generates this electric field, divided by 4 pi epsilon r squared. Remember this? This is basically Coulomb's law and how you can get the electric field from that law. The amount of charge divided by 4 pi epsilon r squared. And again, because we are engineers, we don't assume that the charge are going to be points only. We can assume that we have some distribution of the charge in the volume of a space, right? So rather than putting it in this simple form, we always like integrals. So we write this as the integral of the volumetric charge density, so the charge per unit volume, as an expression of x, y, and z, so around the whole space, right? Integrated with respect to a volume element, that integral of rho v multiplied by dv, total integral is going to give us the q, right? The amount of charge. This is divided by 4 pi epsilon r squared, right? Correct? And by doing this integral, okay, I can get the amount of the electric field at a particular point. What's r? What was this r? The distance between every single element of charge and the location where I'm trying to find the electric field. So for example, I had my charges distributed across this volume, right? So I take an element of volume and I'm looking for the electric field at this point, right? So I'm looking at the electric field at this point. So as I move across the volume, I'm going to encounter different values for r, right? For each element of volume, I will have a different r, correct? So r is gonna vary as I vary across the volume. That's why it's inside that integral. It's not outside, because it's gonna be different for different dv, for different element of volume. Okay. Just a reminder, these things are old information, not new information. So basically, the end result here is I can represent my electric field as a function of, which we know integration, but as a function of the source. What's the source in this case? The volumetric charge density. The expression or the distribution of the charges around space. Similarly, the magnetic field should be representable by some expression that depends on the source of magnetic field. What's the source of magnetic field aside from a lower natural magnet? Because natural magnet, we know, always exists in pairs,
right? So we don't, it's always inside any volume, it's always gonna sum up to zero. So what I care about actually is the other source. What's the other source of magnetic field? Current. It doesn't have to be current. So current in general. If you have a current, you have an associated magnetic field. If the current is time varying, then the magnetic field is gonna be time varying. So in general, the existence of current is going to cause a magnetic field to exist. So I can assume that, and again, the behavior of the magnetic field is very similar to the behavior of the electric field in the form that as you move away from the source of the magnetic field, which is basically the current source, right? You get the magnetic field dropped and the ratio is proportional to 1 over r squared, right? So I can assume that there is some similar expression that rather than including rho v, which is the charge volumetric density, it includes the current. And if I'm looking for current density, then typically you are dealing with Js, current per unit area, current which is flowing into a conductor per unit cross-sectional area, right? Okay? And I will have some divide by r squared as well, because the behavior is the same. As I go away from the source, the value of the magnetic field is going to drop proportional to 1 over r squared, right? Similar to what happens to the electric field, as I go away from the source, it drops proportional to 1 over r squared, tamam? But the constants might be different, okay? Because the magnetic field has different constants that depends on different properties of the material, tamam? And in fact, this does exist, tamam? And the expression in that case is going to be something like, okay, something like, but not exactly, the integral and some J, current per unit area, and it's again integrated over a volume, over the whole conductor volume, okay, and it's divided by some constants, I don't care about the constants, and it's with respect to 1 over r squared. So I have r squared down there. Tamam? Type. Agreed. Now let's look at one extra piece. Electric field was always also associated with some other quantity which was typically easier to calculate, which is what we call V, the electric potential. So what was the relation? The electric potential, V, was equal to the integral of E dot dl. So integration of electric field over length, right? So the only length element in this thing is going to be the r squared. And we actually found, when you studied V, that V can be represented, the electric potential can be represented in terms of the source as Q, again from Coulomb's law, over 4 pi epsilon r only, rather than being r squared, right? This is the electric potential at any point, which is a distance r from a certain charge of value Q. And similarly, we don't like the simpler case. We can write it in the complicated case. So we can say that V is equal to integral rho V dV divided by 4 pi epsilon r instead of r squared. Okay? This is for the electric potential. We can assume, because the behavior of the magnetic field and how it relates to the source is very similar to the behavior of the electric field and how it behaves with respect to source, so we can assume that we can find also another interesting quantity, which is basically, we can call it, in that case, the magnetic potential, and that quantity, rather than depending on r squared, is going to depend only on r, and still, it's going to be an expression of the source. There is a slight difference, though. What's that slight difference? Remember that J itself is a vector, right? The current density is a vector. It has a certain direction depending on which way it's flowing inside the conductor and how our conductor is placed in space, right? So the current density is a vector. So we expect that that potential of the magnetic field, okay, is not going to be a scalar quantity, right? Because it still depends on the source, and that source is vector quantity, right? So we know, we call it A. Typically in the literature, it's called A, and it's called the magnetic potential. So the magnetic potential, tamam? And that magnetic potential is a vector, and we can expect that it will have the expression integration of J integrated with respect to volume, and it's divided by some constants, and the last thing is R instead of R squared.
خلاص.
Now this potential is a vector, right? We will see eventually what's the expression. We'll see how there. But that's not what I'm concerned about. There is a slight now difference added to the one that we discussed. The electric potential is a scalar. The magnetic potential is a vector. Amen? When I want to move from electric potential to electric field, what do I do? What was the relation?
E, which is a vector, was equal to the gradient of V. صح? And the gradient operation is an operation applied to scalar and it gives you a vector value. And it is a derivative with respect to space. تمام? Now I have this dilemma. I need to get the magnetic field B, okay, which is a vector, but I need to get it from the magnetic potential A, which is a vector. What operation, which includes derivative with respect to space, that I can apply to a vector to get a vector?
It's the curl operation. صح? Then I want divergence is going to give me a scalar. I want to get a vector. And I want to get that vector from a vector. So and with a derivative operation.
So the operation naturally should be the curl of A. تمام? And that's exactly how we can get the magnetic field from the magnetic potential. Okay? So number one, the expression of the magnetic potential is what you see here. So remember, it looks exactly similar to what I discussed, aside from two things. Number one, okay, that now we know the values of the constants. Amen? Number two, we have this j tilde e to the minus jkr dash. Where does this come from? In general, my current, okay, inside a conductor is going to be a function of time and space. I'm dealing with steady state analysis, so I can forget the variation with respect to time. And steady state analysis, I forget that in time variation, right? I assume that it's sinusoidal, e to the j omega t, and I take that a j omega t out of the equations. تمام? And later on to incorporate it, I just multiply by e to the j omega t and take the real part. تمام? And I have to account for the space variation. What was the expression for the phasor of a traveling wave at steady state analysis? It was the tilde, one phasor term, multiplied by e to the minus jkr, right? So the only difference here is in my representation in the previous part, when I was talking about this, I was just assuming j without assuming anything about it, whether it's time varying or not, whether it is a traveling wave at steady state analysis or not, I was not assuming anything. Now we are dealing with the case that we have been studying so far, that we are dealing with steady state analysis and our variation is the solution of the wave equation, so our sources follows a phasor with e to the minus jkr and the time variation is e to the j omega t, and that time variation we take it out of the equation because we are doing steady state analysis, خلاص, our frequency domain analysis, okay? So this is the other difference. So two differences, we know the constants, and the second difference is this part. This comes from the fact that now we are going to focus on a traveling wave which is feeding our antenna. خلاص يا جماعة? Okay? Okay. So if this is the case, I can say that given a particular current density inside this antenna, اللي هو j e to the minus jkr dash, تمام? Given that this is a current density inside
this antenna. One thing I want you to notice, okay? E to the minus jk r dash. Where is r dash as compared to the volume?
بس عشان there is gonna be a question in some of you, in some of your minds, okay, or in all your minds, that we mentioned initially that we are dealing with a very short antenna, so we don't really care about variation with respect to z. تمام? لأن dimension very small, so we assume that our current does not vary across the antenna. مظبوط?
True. The assumption is still true, right? But there is an e to the minus jk r dash added there. What's r dash? Look at the pictures. What's r dash?
It's a distance.
Yeah. So this is something outside, right? Why do I have to account for this? Even though inside the antenna, I said that the current is almost not varying because it's a very short. why do I have to account for the r dash and the r or add multiplication by e to the minus jk r dash? You are close, but it has nothing to do with strength. It has to do with the fact that things happen in a delayed fashion, right? So as the magnetic field, or as actually the electric field, or the current flowing inside the conductor, remember that the original picture is that this current is varying with respect to time. Right? That variation with respect to time inside the conductor is supposed to have some variation with respect to time appearing away from the conductor, a distance r dash from the conductor. Right? But it does not appear instantaneously. It appears delayed. How much delayed? Delayed by the distance divided by the traveling speed. Right? How did we represent that? لو عندي source, okay, and it's varying as cosine omega t, okay, and then I assume that at a distance r dash away there will be also variation with respect to time, but it's delayed from the one that happens at the source. How much it is delayed? It's delayed by, let's call it the delay tau. That delay tau is dependent on what? How big is the distance? So it's dependent on r dash divided by the speed of propagation. This is a constant. So as I change my location, the delay is going to be further and further. So that delay must be some constant, right, value multiplied by r dash. صح. مظبوط. And this is going to appear, if I put things in their original representation, the value of the current or the magnetic field which results from the source here is going to be, in general, a cosine omega t as well. But it's delayed. Delayed by how much? By tau. What's the tau? R dash, the distance, تمام? Multiplied by some constant. The constant in this case is 1 over v, 1 over the speed of propagation. If I still have some r dash multiplied by constant inside. Cosine of omega t, the variation with respect to time, multiplied by some constant, multiplied by space dimension. This can be represented as what? E to the minus jkr multiplied by e to the j omega t, and then I take the real part. صح? مظبوط? Because that is going to result in a cosine of omega multiplied by t plus some constant multiplied by distance r. مظبوط? Okay? So this is where this appears. So this is not appearing because my current is varying with respect to the space of the conductor. It's appearing because I'm considering the effect of that variation with respect to time of the current, تمام? In a very short conductor, so it does not really vary with space inside the conductor, only varies with respect to time. But that effect will appear later, will appear retarded, تمام? When I study a distance r away from the source. So I have to also represent that by this e to the minus jkr dash term. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, if you did not get it the first time, repeat this video again so you can capture it. خلاص. So the final expression is gonna be what we see here. Okay. Now this, and let's move on now to resolving all the symbols that we see inside this expression. The first thing is the current density. I have here a conductor, which is, I mean, very short, very thin, so it doesn't, the cross section does not vary from one area to the other. It has a constant cross section. Amen? And the current across the conductor is almost constant with respect to space, and a very short conductor. So I can assume safely that the current per unit area is equal to the initial value of the current, the constant value of the current across the whole conductor, which is I naught. Amen? Don't forget, we took the time variation out. So e to the j omega t is not in the equations, but it's always there. So we only consider variation with respect to space. Now, within the conductor, there's no variation with respect to space. Okay? So it's I naught divided by the cross-sectional area. This is going to be current per unit area. And the cross-sectional area is a constant. So it's a constant value equal to I naught divided by S. This is the phasor of the j, the current density per unit area. In which direction the current is moving in the z direction? So it is in the z hat direction. خلاص. So my current is moving with the conductor, and the conductor is aligned with the z axis. So it is in the z hat direction. Positive or negative? It depends on I note. تمام. It's going to be positive or negative. So we just assume it's in the z hat, and the exact direction up or down is going to be specified by how your source is behaving. خلاص. Okay. Second thing is dV. Here we are integrating the current over the volume carrying the current. يبقى احنا نتكلم على volume of the conductor itself. خلاص. What's an element of volume of this conductor? Again, constant cross-sectional area S multiplied by length. ده كأنه cylinder. صح؟ Each piece of that antenna is a cylinder. A cylinder with constant cross-sectional area. So what's the total volume of that cylinder? It's going to be an element of length multiplied by the constant cross section. يبقى dV is equal to S multiplied by dZ. خلاص. Anyone disagrees? أهو. Conductor أهو. Okay. An element of volume. Assume that I take very short piece of that. It will have a constant cross sectional area S. And it is a cylinder of very short height, which is dZ. تمام. So the total volume of that is going to be the area of the base multiplied by the height of the cylinder. The height of the cylinder is dz, and the area of the base is constant, s, always. خلاص? Okay. One remaining thing is, because this antenna is too short, right? The difference between the actual distance from the element that I pick, now I want to show you what was there. So, remember that here, I am doing this integral, right, for every single element of volume, dV. So assume, for example, that I consider this element of volume at one point. تمام? Then the distance of this from the location where I'm trying to calculate the electric and the magnetic field is dependent which element I pick, right? But because this whole thing is short, then the difference between this and this is very small. You can neglect it, right? لو عندي two lines of a triangle and the third line of the triangle is very short, the difference between those two lines is going to be very, very small. Almost zero, so you can ignore that. Negligible. You cannot say zero, but it's negligible. So we can assume that regardless of which element I pick, the distance is always approximately going to be equal to R. What's R? R is the distance from the center of the antenna. I can approximate all the other distances as constant equal to that R without really a big error. تمام? And it's very good approximation. So now I can rewrite this expression after substituting J, substituting dV, and assuming that R is now a constant. So I can take it outside. So regardless where I am inside the volume of the antenna, R is a constant value, so I can take it outside the integral. مظبوط? خلاص? So the end result is going to be this. تمام? I integrate over the volume of the antenna, which is basically integrated over Z with a constant cross-sectional area. And when I take J is equal to I naught divided by S, when I take J multiplied by dV, the S is going to cancel with the S, so I end up with only dZ. And that's what I have here, dZ only. And the integral is over Z, because the volume is S, dV is equal to S, dZ. So the integral becomes a single integral over the Z dimension. So simply, again, this integral is very easy to solve. صح? It's just an integral of dz and everything else is constant. So you can take everything outside and integrate. The result is going to be L. Then you integrate from the start of the antenna until the end, assuming that the antenna has a length L, and assuming that I align my axes such that the antenna is in the z direction and the center of the antenna is at the origin. خلاص يبقى معنى كده ان انا بانتجريت from minus L over 2 up to L over 2 اللي هو what we see here. تمام. So the result of this integral is simply L. So you end up with this expression for the magnetic vector potential. So now I have an expression for the magnetic vector potential at any point U, which is the distance R from the center of the antenna. I know exactly how the magnetic field looks like at a distance R from the center of the antenna, but not the magnetic field, the magnetic potential. How can I get the magnetic fields from this? Just take the curve, صح? We know that B is equal to the curl of A. So the only thing remaining is to take the curl. But before doing that, the expression that I got for the magnetic potential is a function of Cartesian coordinates, x, y, z. Now, if you look at the geometry of this problem, you will find that typically, with this Cartesian dipole being a very small point, you are going to be around that point, and it's better, because of the symmetry of this geometry, that you use spherical axis instead of the Cartesian, x, y, z. Okay? So I need to convert this into spherical axis. How do you do the conversion? Remember the table that I gave you in the review that shows you how to move from one axis to the other? If you go to that table, you want that z hat, which is shown down there, z hat, okay, is equal to r hat cosine theta minus theta hat sine theta. So if I have something in the z direction, it has to be broken into two components, one in the r direction, one in the theta direction, with those values. So simply, I'm going to go for that expression of the magnetic potential and replace z hat with this. So I end up with this expression for the magnetic potential, but now in the r theta and phi, اللي هما spherical coordinates. تمام? Notice that I only have r component and theta component. There is no phi component. Okay, there is no component of the magnetic potential in the phi direction. When you take the curl of this to get your magnetic field, you will find an interesting result, which is basically that you end up, when you take the curl, and taking the curl is just an operation, you can also look it up in the tables that I gave you, you will find that your magnetic field is going to be only in the phi direction. So the potential was in theta and r, but what I'm looking for is actually h or b, your magnetic field. So when I take the curl, I will find that I have only a magnetic field in the phi direction. Expectedly, I have a wire carrying conductor. Remember how was the magnetic field around the wire? It was circles, right? Which is the phi direction. So that was expected from the beginning, but I have to do the derivation. Okay? So this is the magnetic field. Okay? What remains is to get the electric field. How do I do that? Maxwell's equations, one of Maxwell's equations tells you that for considering the case of phasors, the variation with respect to time is equal to the j omega t. The main derivative with respect to time is going to give me division by j omega or multiplication by j omega. And after modifying, this was one of the Maxwell's equations, that E is equal to 1 over j omega epsilon root curl H. Okay? So I apply this equation to H, I can get the electric field. Notice now that the electric field is not as nice as the magnetic field.
Because the magnetic has only a phi component, but unfortunately the electric has an r and theta. Again, as engineers, we don't like this. It's too much. Let's remember that we are dealing with far field, right? So if you are dealing with far field, then this r is really very big, right? I have to take advantage of this. It's big compared to lambda. So as an engineer, I want to approximate these expressions and make them simpler, and I get advantage of this. Look at this expression. Typically,
r, we said, is much greater than lambda. What's going to be kr? Kr is equal to what? 2 pi over lambda, that's k, multiplied by r, which is equal to 2 pi multiplied by r divided by lambda. If r is too big compared to lambda, so r over lambda is going to be what? A very large number or a very small number compared to 1? Very large number. R is much bigger than lambda. So this r over lambda, and again multiplied by 2 pi, which is a number greater than 1, this must be much greater than 1. Tamam? If it's much greater than 1, I can definitely approximate those fractions, particularly the ones that has kr squared. If kr is much bigger than 1, then kr squared is really, really big, right? Compared to 1. Tamam? So if I divide by those, I can assume that it's going to be 0. Because of far field approximation, far field, okay, I can go to these equations and say this is zero. Tamam? This and this are zero because both of them are really, really small numbers. And this is zero. This is zero. So I remain with what? There is no electric field in the direction of R. There is a magnetic field in the direction of H, which depends only on J depends only on 1 over r. There is an electric field in the direction only of theta, which depends only on 1 over r. صح؟ Okay, so that final expression. Now this just shows you how the electric field looks like around the Hertzian dipole. So the Hertzian dipole is aligned with the z-axis, and your electric field will look like this, like what you see here. It's theta direction. فاكرين theta is the angle from the z-axis. تمام؟ So that's why the electric field is like going up and down in circles, right? Because it's in the theta direction. خلاص؟ ده approximated electric field. So basically we ignore these parts. That's part of our absorption. As you go away from the radiating antenna, as you are far from the antenna, studying the far field, you can ignore these guys. And you assume that most of the time, in all these ranges, you will have only an electric field in theta direction, which is a very good approximation. So the final expressions are going to be what you see down there in this box.
That the electric field is given by this expression, which is only dependent on 1 over r, and it is only in the theta direction. And the magnetic field, we saw the expression, just go there and make this zero. We will find one more interesting property in this case. Right? We have electric field in one direction, we have magnetic field in another direction, phi, and our wave is a propagating wave in the r direction, in the remaining perpendicular direction. Tamam? Not only that, the electric field and the magnetic field, after this approximation, which is in the far field, are related by the common relation that we studied for plane wave propagation. That the magnetic field is equal to the electric divided by the intrinsic impedance. So even though this wave is not plane, right, because we have theta and phi, so it's not in a plane, it's not x and y, right? It will in general have components in all directions, tamam? But it has the nice properties that are very similar to the plane wave propagation. The electric field is perpendicular to the magnetic field. Both of them are perpendicular to the direction of propagation. And the relation between the electric and the magnetic field is such that H is equal to E divided by the intrinsic impedance. So it's not plane wave, but it behaves like a plane wave. It's actually a spherical wave. تمام? لأنها propagating in the direction of R, يبقى the wave front is a surface of a sphere, not a plane. But it is very similar to the plane wave in terms of the properties. خلاص يا جماعة؟ Again, if you are really, really, really far, you can assume that it's no longer R with theta and phi, it's actually X, Y, and Z, right? You can always assume that if you're really, really far. But even if you are not that, that much far, it still has all the nice properties of the plane wave. خلاص؟ So the final thing is, if I have a Hertzian dipole, this is the final thing, this is the expression of the electric and the magnetic field. تمام؟ I can get one from the other using the intrinsic impedance, and these are the directions. If it's propagating in the direction of R, away from the point where the Hertzian dipole is placed in all directions, that R direction. So if this is my Hertzian dipole, my wave is propagating this way, right? In all radial directions. تمام؟ Assuming that this is a sphere, not just a circle. تمام؟ And it has an electric field in the theta direction and a magnetic field in the phi direction. خلاص؟ Given by this expression. Now, if I have electric and magnetic field, then I know from what we looked at before in the plane wave propagation that I can get the associated power by doing what? The associated average power per unit area is equal to half the real of E cross H conjugate. We looked at this in the plane wave propagation problem. And I do have E and H, so I can do this cross product. And if I do this cross product, again, what's going to be the direction of this S average? Propagation direction, right? So the energy or the power is carried in the direction of propagation. Right? And it's given by half real of E cross H. Don't forget, this is type average probability. That's why we have the half and the conjugate here. Okay? Now, this is in the R hat direction, direction of propagation. In general, it's going to be a function of, if you look at the electric field and the magnetic field, they are a function of only two variables. They have the two variables only. R and theta. They are not a function of phi. So basically, in this system, as I rotate around the antenna, maintaining the same distance and the same elevation angle, so I rotate in a circle, tamam, parallel to the xy plane, I will not get any variation of the electric or the magnetic field. Only if I move up or down, or I get away or closer. خلاص يا جماعة؟ Because it's only electric and magnetic field are only a function of r and theta. مظبوط؟ It's not a function of phi. So I expect that E cross H is also going to be a function of r and theta. No phi will appear. If I multiply things that are a function of r and theta, I will get something which is in general a function of r and theta. تمام؟ And that's the expression. Simply, you take that one, you square, and you don't forget that there is a division by E times. So this is where you get this expression. Tamam? It's proportional to square the current value. It's proportional to square the length of the antenna. Okay? It's proportional to K is equal to what? 2 pi over lambda. So it's proportional to 1 over lambda squared. يعني كل ما زود الwavelength يحصل ايه؟ If I increase lambda, what happens to the radiated power density?
Decreases,
because it's proportional to when I increase the wavelength. Amen? Then this K is becoming smaller. So if this becomes smaller, this whole expression becomes smaller. يبقى لما زود الفريكونسي يحصل ايه؟ Frequency is inversely proportional to the wavelength. Increasing frequency means making wavelength smaller. Making wavelength smaller means this is becoming larger. This is why they talk to you about, for example, for this particular antenna, مثلا, very short antenna, when you have the 2.4 gig wireless phone or cordless phone, and then they talk about moving to the 5 gig because they can use the same antenna but radiate more power. Same antenna dimension but radiate more power because you increase the frequency, so that allows you to push more power into the medium from the same antenna. You don't have to enlarge your antenna. Okay? And the usual thing, as I get away from the source, the R, I lose the power proportional to 1 over R squared. I will ask you a question about this. And the last thing is, which is very interesting again, is if this is how my antenna is placed, in the z direction, for example, then if I am here, like away from the center of the antenna in a symmetric way, I will get the maximum radiation because theta in this case is 90 degrees. Theta is measured from z, right, in clockwise direction. Tamam? But if I go up and I stand right above the antenna, I will get no power at all because theta is equal to zero and this expression is going to be equal to zero. Tamam? Now, in this expression, which is S, the radiated power per unit area, as a function of r and theta, in general, regardless of the geometry of the antenna, you will end up with something 1 over r squared. So whatever the antenna, Hertzian dipole, dish, aperture antenna, slot antenna, whatever, you will always have 1 over r squared. And I will discuss in a minute why. خلاص? So basically, this does not really characterize this antenna. Only says that if I get away from the antenna, I will lose power 1 over r squared. So I can remove this from the specs of the antenna. It's useless because it's the same for all antennas regardless. Amen? All the other constants, things that are dependent on the dimension, things that are dependent on the feeding current and all these things, and also dependency on lambda, again, they are common to most antennas, actually all antennas. If I feed more current, I will get more radiated power. If I use higher frequency, I will get better radiation. If I increase the length of the antenna or dimension of the antenna, I will get an increased radiation, right? The only differentiating factor in this is how the radiation of the antenna is changing with respect to theta as I go up and down, and phi as I rotate around the antenna. Right? So typically, we assume that this whole thing is a constant. We call it S naught. Everything that depends on any geometry or any feeding or any frequency, we take it outside, we consider it as a constant, right? We call it S naught, and we only leave the function that depends on theta from the z-axis and phi rotating around the antenna. And this S naught is the maximum that can happen for a particular theta. If I pick the theta and the phi that gives me the maximum, then what I will get is S naught. So I consider this as if it's the amplitude, the maximum value. And I characterize the antenna by taking this expression S divided by S naught. I end up with something which is only a function of theta, and if there was phi, it's going to be a function of phi. Tamam? That thing is called the radiation pattern or the radiation intensity of the antenna.
If you go and look at the specs of any antenna, you will find something called the radiation pattern or the radiation intensity. And it's always going to draw for you the amount of radiated power normalized to the maximum.
So it's going to be some value which is one or this in blue curve there. Tamam? And it's going to be as a function of theta. So as you move from different angles, you have different values which is plotting this. Notice that the plot is not x, y. It's for a particular angle, for example, for 0 angle, I have 0 value. For 10 degrees angle, I have value here and here, right? It's always up and down and symmetric, right? And so on until I get the maximum when I am at 90 degrees, okay? And similarly, I can plot this for phi. For this antenna for phi, there is no dependence, so it's always the maximum value, regardless how you rotate around it, right? There is no variation with respect to phi, so that's why it's a circle. خلاص يا جماعة?
These two plots are called the pattern of the antenna with respect to elevation angle and azimuth angle. اللي هي الفاي, azimuth, والelevation اللي هي theta. تمام? This is the normalized intensity as a function of theta and the normalized intensity as a function of phi. And these are the specs of the antenna. We'll stop here. تمام? ما خدناش break النهاردة.